I just want to say to you, David, that there could not have been a better song to sing. Is that right? Yeah, I'm constantly amazed at just how the Lord works in these things. And it's just such a good song for us to sing before we read and study the Word of God tonight. Brian, do you want to take a seat just now for a wee while? Well, we're going to be reading, first of all, from the book of Genesis, chapter 11. I'll give you a minute or two to just look it up. Well, my text for us for the new year, for 2022, is this. Is anything too hard for the Lord? And it's a sentence that you'll find in Genesis chapter 18 and verse 14. Is anything too hard for the Lord? And the context of it is God's promise to give Abraham and Sarah a son when they were very old. The Lord actually gave a very similar promise to a very young woman. She was incredulous when she was visited by an angel about 2,000 years ago, about 2,000 years after Abram and Sarah received promises from God. And she was told that she was going to have a son who would be conceived by the Holy Spirit. And here's what the angel had to say to her. No word from the Lord will ever fail. In some translations, we have it this way, that there is nothing that is impossible for God. And so, just right at the start tonight, I just want to ask you, do you believe that? There is nothing that is impossible for God. You know, I've got to admit there are times when I just can't see how God is going to change a circumstance. But he wants us to believe that he is the God who can move mountains, who can change circumstances, who could do things that we just never thought could ever happen. And so at the start of this year, 2022, may the Holy Spirit just etch into our beings the resilience through faith to believe in the word and the promises of God. Are we up for that? Well, our example tonight, our lesson tonight, is from the life of Abraham in the book of Genesis. And we'll read first of all, there's quite a number of readings tonight, but we'll read first of all from the end of chapter 11. And verse 27 begins with Abram's father. This is the account of Terah's family life line. Terah became the father of Abram, Nahor, and Haran. And Haran became the father of Lot. While his father Terah was still alive, Haran died in Ur of the Chaldeans, in the land of his birth. Abram and Nahor were both married. The name of Abram's wife was Sarai, and the name of Nahor's wife was Milcah. She was the daughter of Haran, and the father of both Milcah and Ishka. This is where it gets really quite complicated. Verse 30. Now Sarai was childless because she was not able to conceive. Terah took his son Abram, his grandson Lot, son of Haran, and his daughter-in-law Sarai, the wife of his son Abram. And together they set out from Ur of the Chaldeans to go to Canaan. But when they came to Haran, they settled there, and Terah lived 205 years, and he died in Haran. So, Lord, as we come to study your word this evening, we pray that you would open our eyes to the things that you want us to hear, the truths that will impact our life. And just as you moved in the family of Terah 4,000 years ago, we pray that you would be the God who moves in our lives today. So, Lord, would you come and would you speak through your word this evening? We ask in Jesus' name. Amen. Now, in Genesis chapter 11, I don't know if we can manage to get the PowerPoint up. I have got a map. But if we don't manage to get it, then I'll talk you through it. But at the end of Genesis chapter 11, we're introduced to Abram's family and location of their family in verses 27 through to 30. And then in three brief sentences, here's what it says. We are told about Terah's plan to relocate his family, except for Nahor, who would be left behind, from Ur to Canaan, something like 600 miles away. And we've got a map. Okay. It was actually an epic adventure. If you want to have a look up at the map, I don't have my pointer. But over on the right-hand side here, we have the city of Ur, the ancient city of Ur, which is a very important city in the ancient world. And Terah set up, and Ur would be in modern-day Iraq. And they set off following the line of the Euphrates River to go northwest, and they came to the point where they would turn to go back down again by the coastal route to the land of Canaan. But they got as far as Haran, which you see in the very top of the map there, and for some reason they stopped. In some ways we couldn't blame them. After traveling something like 400 or 500 miles with your family and everything that you possess, I think you would be ready to have a stop. And that is where they stopped. And we're told that they settled in Haran. They didn't go any further. We don't know why they were heading for the land of Canaan. The word of God doesn't tell us. But Terah, Abram's dad, dies there at the age of 205. Well, in terms of the generations that go before him in the book of Genesis, he was actually a youngster. But he died at the age of 205. However, the plan for them to go to Canaan was actually God's plan. I don't know the background to this, whether God actually prompted Dad Terah that he was to go to Canaan. But anyway, he stopped part of the way there. But God wants that family in the land of Canaan. And so here we begin to discover God is speaking. And God starts to speak into the heart and into the life of this really important man in the Old Testament called Abram. So we're now going to read from chapter 12. And we've been singing about faith. We're going to have an example of big faith tonight. The Lord had said to Abram, "Go from your country, your people, and your father's household to the land I will show you. I will make you into a great nation, and I will bless you. I will make your name great, and you will be a blessing. I will bless them who bless you, and whoever curses you, I will curse. And all peoples on earth will be blessed through you." So Abram went, as the Lord had told him, and Lot went with him. Abram was 75 years old when he set out from Haran. He took his wife Sarai, his nephew Lot, all the possessions they had accumulated, and the people they had acquired in Haran, and they set out for the land of Canaan, and they arrived there. Abram traveled through the land as far as the site of the great tree of Moreh at Shechem. At that time, the Canaanites were in the land, And the Lord appeared to Abram and said, to your offspring I will give this land. So he built an altar there to the Lord who had appeared to him. And from there he went on towards the hills east of Bethel and pitched his tent with Bethel on the west and Ai on the east. And there he built an altar to the Lord and called on the name of the Lord. Now, I don't know how good your eyesight is, but you can actually see the town of Shechem right over on the west side of the map, quite close to the sea, just underneath the word Canaan, the land of Canaan. So God begins to speak to Abram when he was 75 years old. Can you imagine it? At the age of 75, the poor old codger that he was. Yeah. Some of you here know that I had an important birthday last week, and we celebrated it actually a week past on Saturday. But one of my cards I just loved. I'm going to read it to you. You know you get lots of funny cards nowadays. But here's what it says. You're not 70. I like that. You're 18 with 52 years of experience. There's a bit of truth in that, isn't there? You know, the older you get, the more of life's experience that you have built up. You know, I'm hoping that God still speaks to me at my codgerish age. Because I'm conscious that God has spoken to V and I all through our lives. Not constantly, but there have been these moments, these important moments in our lives when God has something really important to say to us. And I so much hope that he continues to do that. And here at the age of 75, God speaks to Abram. So it's never too late for God to speak to you and to use you. I want to say that to us all tonight. It's never too late for God to speak to you. And you're never too young for God to speak to you. I think the important thing is that we have the expectation that we're going to hear the voice of God. Well, Abraham heard the voice of God and he's told to leave his family behind, his comfortable and successful life in Haran. The family had settled there. They had accumulated great wealth there. You know, in the terms of the natural, in worldly terms, they were hugely successful. Why would they want to move on? The reason they would want to go on is because God told them to move on. When God speaks to you and sometimes surprises you in your comfortable life, and God might say to you, leave it all behind because I've got something else for you to do somewhere else. I wonder how you would respond. How would you respond? There was a day when Jesus walked along the shores of Galilee and he came across some fishermen. And he just said to them, come, follow me, and I will make you fishers of men. Successful businessmen with all of their lives before them. What did they do? They didn't say, go away, forget it. They left their nets and they followed Jesus. And Abraham obeys the Lord. And they continue their journey and they head for the land of Canaan. And they come to Shechem. And then God reveals the full extent of his plan to Abram to give him children and to give him lands. Isn't that exciting? It was exciting. It was very exciting for Abram to the extent that he just fell down and worshipped. He built an altar and he worshipped God. I think he fell down on his knees. We were hearing Brian speaking last week about worshipping God. I think he got down on his knees and he worshipped the God of heaven who had come to speak to him. I want us to think just for a little while about coming to terms with unfulfilled dreams and promises. And for that, we need to go to Genesis chapter 15. And the first seven verses say this: after this, the word of the Lord came to Abram in a vision. Don't be afraid, Abram. I am your shield, your very great reward. But Abram said, Sovereign Lord, what can you give me since I remain childless? And the one who will inherit my estate is Eliezer of Damascus. And Abram said, you have given me no children, so a servant is in my household, and he will be my heir. Then the word of the Lord came to him. This man will not be your heir, but a son who is your own flesh and blood will be your heir. He took him outside and said, look up at the sky and count the stars, and if indeed you can count them. Then he said to him, so shall your offspring be. And Abram believed the Lord, and he credited it to him as righteousness. He said to him, I am the Lord who brought you out of Ur of the Chaldeans to give you this land to take possession of it. Years had passed, and Abram is rich in every way except one way. He didn't have any children. And he's at the place of saying to God, God, you haven't kept your promises. In verse 3, really. That's what he's saying. You have given me no children. It's effectively he's saying, God, you haven't been a promise keeper. Coming to terms with unfulfilled dreams and promises. You see, God's time scale is different from our time scale. We live in a fast-moving world and we expect things to happen quickly. And it's the same in the spiritual realm, I think. We expect things to happen very quickly. We have hopes and dreams and we give them to God, and effectively we almost say, Lord, we want to see it happening now. I've got to be honest with you, you know, when God called V and I to do this great work of staying here and building the living rooms, and he provided for us in such a wonderful way, I think our expectation was that people would come to know the Lord Jesus in great numbers. In great numbers, that we would be given spiritual children, if you like, that this is what was going to happen. And I tell you, we've grown very impatient about that, if I'm being absolutely honest, because we haven't seen the numbers of people in this area coming to faith in the Lord Jesus that we expected. Have you? Have you? Is that your dream? Is that what you want to see? Above everything else. I tell you, that's my dream. To see people rescued and brought into the family of God. Unfulfilled dreams and promises. Sometimes God asks us to wait. Maybe some of us feel at the point, well, we want to give up. But God actually can make us wait because he wants to test our faith, the reality of our faith in him. And I think that's what God is doing in Abram's life. And Abram is saying to God, God, you haven't given me any children. And then God speaks to him again and says, a son who is your own flesh and blood will be your heir. God reaffirms his promise to Abram, and he makes a covenant with Abram, verse 18. We didn't actually read about that, but there's something about a covenant. It's something that's firm, it's sure. It's something that will be kept. And God makes a covenant with Abram, and Abram's faith is strengthened. And verse 6, we read this, Abram believed in God, and he credited it to him as righteousness. Even in his very old age, how is it possible for me to have a son? How is it possible for my wife to have a son? After all these years, it seemed impossible. And in verse 6, it says, Abram believed in God, and God credited to him as righteousness. I don't know if you realize that, but that's a very important verse. And for the very first time, God reveals a huge truth about his grace and about his goodness. And when we believe in God, when we believe in the Lord Jesus, here's what he does. He does for us exactly what he did for Abram. When we believe in the Lord Jesus Christ, he reckons, he credits his righteousness to us. I'm going to read to you some verses from Romans chapter 4. And here's what it says. What the scriptures say? Abram believed God, and it was credited to him as righteousness. Now, to the one who works, wages are not credited as a gift, but as an obligation. In other words, when you work and you receive a wage, you earn that wage. It's an obligation. However, to the one who does not work, but trusts God who justifies the ungodly, their faith is credited as righteousness. David says the same thing when he speaks of the blessedness of the one to whom God credits righteousness apart from works. Blessed are those whose transgressions are forgiven, whose sins are covered. Blessed is the one whose sin the Lord will never count against them. And so, here's Abram. It seems absolutely impossible that God could keep his promise, because Abram's thinking in the natural, isn't he? And we would do exactly the same. Complete impossibility that they could have a child. But God says you will have a child. He will be your own flesh and blood. And what does Abram do? He believes God. And God credits it to him as righteousness. It's an accounting term. Yeah? God wants to reward Abraham for his faith. And he looks on him as a righteous man, as one who's obedient to him, as a man who trusts God, that he is the God who is able to do the impossible. What does it mean for us today? The doctrine is actually called imputation. Yeah, it's about reckoning, charging to an account, right? And when Jesus died on the cross, he took our sins on that cross upon himself. It was charged to him. It was reckoned to him. All our sins were placed on Jesus. And when we come to the cross, and when we put our faith in Jesus Christ, here's what happens. And it's wonderful. God credits it as righteousness to us. In other words, God places all the righteousness of Christ on us. When we come to faith in Jesus Christ, when we become a Christian, God doesn't see us as hopeless sinners anymore, but he sees us just like his son. Isn't that wonderful? He sees us as pure. He sees us just as if we're holy. He sees us as just as if we're sinless. He credits to us, wonder of wonders, all the beauty and all the perfection of the Lord Jesus Christ. He credits it to us as righteousness. If we have faith, and that is the important thing, is having the faith. Do we really believe it? If you're here tonight and you say, well, I'm a Christian, do you really believe in Jesus Christ? Is he the number one in your life? Will you follow him no matter what? Will you give your everything and your all to him? Because that's what faith in Christ means. It's not just an acknowledgement with our lips. It's something that goes on in our hearts. And we have to really mean it because God knows it and he sees our hearts. Do we really believe? That's faith. And if we really believe, God credits us with the righteousness of Christ. It's a wonderful truth. And Abram believed in God. Now let's read from Genesis chapter 16. And we're going to learn now about misplaced faith. Okay? It's possible to have misplaced faith when we take God's promises out of his control and into our hands. Right? Genesis chapter 16, verses 1 to 4. Now Sarai, Abram's wife, had borne him no children, but she had an Egyptian slave named Hagar. So she said to Abram, "The Lord has kept me from having children. Go sleep with my slave. Perhaps I can build a family through her." Abram agreed to what Sarai said. So after Abram had been living in Canaan 10 years, Sarai, his wife, took her Egyptian slave, Hagar, and gave her to her husband to be his wife. And he slept with Hagar, and she conceived. Verse 15. So Hagar bore Abram a son, and Abram gave the name Ishmael to the son she had born. And Abram was 86 years old when Hagar bore him Ishmael. Well, something like 10 years had passed since God had made this covenant with Abram and said, you're going to have a son, and he's going to be your own flesh and blood. 10 years had passed. 10 years is actually quite a long time. 10 years is a very long time if you're 11 or 12 or 13. But I want to tell you, even when you get to 70, 10 years is a long time. And a lot can happen in 10 years. And you can have a lot of disappointment in 10 years if what you thought had been promised has never actually come to pass. And so it was with Abram and with Sarah. God had promised that they would have a child. It seemed impossible, but God had promised it. And 10 years later, it had not happened. And here's what they did. They took the matter into their own hands. They tried to give God a little bit of help. And this is what I talk about, misplaced faith. There can be times when God makes us a promise, but we take things into our own hands. And we drive it forward ourselves. And that's what Abraham and Sarah were doing. And Sarah had a young servant girl. And she said to her husband, if you can have a child by you, why don't you go and have a child with her? And wonder of wonders, 1 year later, a child is born. And it's a son. And his name is Ishmael. Well, is this going to be the answer to what God has promised? Well, actually, what we discover is that they made a big mistake. They made a big mistake. They took things into their own hands. And Abram has a son to Hagar. And their world begins to unravel. As a result of that one wrong decision, they were going to regret it for the rest of their lives. The trouble it was going to cause in the family. You know, these things do happen. So many families, one wrong decision, and the family just unraveled. Think about David. One wrong decision, and it proved to be disastrous. Not only that, but there was silence from heaven for another 13 years. Silence from heaven. I think, you know, when Abram and Sarah offended God, he really was offended. When they disobeyed him, he became silent. I think that's something that can happen. When we consciously go against God's plan for our lives, and then we don't hear the voice of God anymore, we think, what's wrong? What's happened? Why don't you speak to me anymore? I think it's because God says, well, if you want to go do it your way, I'm going to let you do it your way. Very important lesson, I think, for us to learn in spiritual things. I don't think God is someone whom we can call up when we want him to call up, when we want to call him up in our times of need and in our times of trouble. But what God really responds to is faithfulness and obedience in our lives. And they'd been disobedient, and now there was going to be 13 years of silence. And by then, you would think, well, it's too late now. It's absolutely impossible for God to keep his promises. But at the age of 99, and when Sarah is 89, God speaks again. Isn't that wonderful? Because he's a God who keeps his promises. Have you ever felt that way? Have you ever felt absolutely forgotten by God? You know, he doesn't care about me anymore. He doesn't listen to me. I don't feel as if he's near. He's there. He loves you. If you turn to him and you cry out to him, he will speak to you. He will draw near to you. And Paul describes the dilemma, the disappointment of Abram and Sarah at that great age as he writes 2,000 years later, and he says this: Abram faced the fact that he was as good as dead, and Sarah's womb was also dead. The thing had moved from being impossible to needing a miracle. And then God speaks again. So we'll read in chapter 17 now. When Abram was 99 years old, the Lord appeared to him and said, I am God Almighty, El Shaddai. I am God Almighty, walk before me faithfully and be blameless. Then I will make my covenant between me and you and will greatly increase your numbers. Really, God? Is that possible? And Abraham fell face down. That's the way you go when you worship, when you really worship. And God said to him, as for me, this is my covenant with you. You will be the father of many nations. No longer will you be called Abram. Your name will be Abraham, for I have made you a father of many nations. That's what his name would mean. I will make you very fruitful. I will make nations of you, and kings will come from you. I will establish my covenant as an everlasting covenant between me and you and your descendants after you, for the generations to come, to be your God and the God of your descendants after you. The whole land of Canaan, where you now reside as a foreigner, I will give as an everlasting possession to you and your descendants after you. Verse 15. God also said to Abram, as for Sarai, your wife, you are no longer to call her Sarai. Her name will be Sarah. I will bless her and will surely give you a son by her. I will bless her so that she will be the mother of nations. Kings of peoples will come from her. And Abram fell face down. He laughed and said to himself, will a son be born to a man 100 years old? Will Sarah bear a child at the age of 90? And Abram said to God, if only Ishmael might live under your blessing. Then God said, yes, but your wife Sarah will bear you a son, and you will call him Isaac. I will establish my covenant with him as an everlasting covenant for his descendants after him. And 1 year later, the child, Isaac, was born. When things seem impossible, God renews his promise. He tells them, you're going to have a son. And your son is going to be born through your wife, Sarah. And then he does something else that's really important. He gives them the title deeds to the land of Israel. That's why the land of Israel is so important today. And why the Jewish people are so passionate about their land, despite all the opposition. And despite the people who would want to take them out of their land, they can turn to this passage and say, this is the title deeds to our land. And I remember, just was it a couple of years ago, the Israeli ambassador to the United Nations stood up in the United Nations. And what did he do? He read these verses out to the United Nations ambassadors. And said, these are the title deeds of the land of Israel. Yeah. And they were given to Abram that day. And 1 year later, Isaac is born. Do you know what Isaac means? If you got a good Bible, you'll be able to tell me. He laughs. Yes. He laughs. What joy there was in that family the day that Isaac was born. Not only was a child born, but a nation, a very special nation, is born. And he is the God of the impossible, isn't he? He is the God of the impossible. I want to remind you that 2,000 years later, another miracle child is born. His name is Jesus, the Son of God, who was promised a young woman who wasn't married, that she would have a baby, and that child would be conceived of the Holy Spirit. She was incredulous, but she believed, and it happened. And she gave birth to Jesus, the Son of God, the Savior of sinners, and from him a great nation has grown. A kingdom has been established that's growing and advancing and will continue to grow and advance until Jesus comes again. Because Mary believed the word of God. My closing reading is again from the book of Romans, because Paul connects what happened to Abraham with what happens to us today in New Testament times. And he says this, against all hope, in chapter 4, verse 18, against all hope, Abram in hope believed, and so became the father of many nations, just as it had been said to him, so shall your offspring be. Without weakening in his faith. Listen to that. You read the story, you think, what? He never weakened in his faith? I don't think actually he did weaken in his faith. He just tried to take things into his own hands. and God had to show him differently. But without weakening in his faith, he faced the fact that his body was as good as dead, since he was about 100 years old and that Sarah's womb was also dead. Yet he did not waver through unbelief regarding the promise of God, but was strengthened in his faith and gave glory to God, being fully persuaded that God had power to do what he had promised. This is why it was credited to him as righteousness. The words "it was credited to him" were written not for him alone, but also for us, to whom God will credit righteousness, for us who believe in him who raised Jesus our Lord from the dead. He was delivered over to death for our sins and was raised to life for our justification. And if you don't know what the word justification means, it means simply this: so that we might be declared not guilty before a holy God, because we received the righteousness of Jesus Christ. Not by works that we have done, but by through his wonderful gift of grace. He's an amazing God, isn't he? He is an amazing God, and he loves you so much, and he loves me so much. And he wants to bless us in our lives, just as he blessed Abraham and Sarah. And so as we set out in 2022, I want to ask you the question that I asked you at the beginning. Do you believe that God is the God who can do the impossible? Are you expecting that God will do great things this year? I don't think you're very sure. But I'm living in expectation that God is going to move in power. Some of you are maybe looking for God to heal you. Some of you may be looking to God to change your family circumstances or your personal circumstances. A week ago, our Alison was looking to God to direct her for the future. Isn't that right, Alison? You were. She was going to an important interview and she wasn't prepared. She didn't feel as if she was ready for this interview. And what did she do? She asked the fellowship to pray, and we were all praying. And you've heard her give testimony tonight. It couldn't have gone any better than it went. I think God was affirming to Ali the direction he wants her to go. So for the decisions in your life in 2022, are you going to make them on your own? Are you going to bring them to the Lord? Relationships that you're going to have as you're growing up. Things that God might be asking you to do. Are you doing it in your own strength, or is it because you've got this assurance in your heart of the Holy Spirit? God is really prompting you and prodding you to do this thing for him. Don't say no. Say yes to God. You say, I just don't feel ready. I don't feel equipped. I don't feel good enough. Well, I want to tell you, the Old Testament is full of people who said, I can't do it. I'm not good enough. There's a Gideon, there's a Moses, and I could go on and on and on. And God spoke to them and he said to them, I want you to do this for me. And they said, oh, wait a minute. No, I'm not ready. I'm not equipped. When God calls, he equips and he enables us to achieve what we might think in our hearts is impossible for us to achieve. To change circumstances that we think are maybe impossible to change. Yet God might ask us to wait 10 years, 20 years, 30 years before he finally gives us the answer. What does he ask us to do? Trust him. Be strong in faith. Be unwavering. I'm the God who can do the impossible. God bless us all. It's all tonight. And as always, if anyone would like prayer afterwards, just come and grab a hold of me. And I'll be more than happy to pray with you.